In this video, I'm going to summarize the ideas for solving systems of linear inequalities. We actually have worked through a few examples of solving linear inequalities using a method which is known as Fourier-Motzkin elimination method. Well, the method is based on the following observation. Suppose I have a system of inequalities, say every inequality is greater than or equal to. Now, pick a variable, put that on the left-hand side, and everything else, constants and other variables, on the right-hand side. So rewrite our system in the following manner, and we normalize the coefficients of x so that the coefficient of x is either 1 or minus 1. So my system looks like this. Now say I have p of these constraints up here, q of these in the middle, and r of these. So these r inequalities do not have the variable x, but may have some other stuff. To eliminate x, all we need to do is to make sure that each of these lower bounds from one of these p inequalities is at most the upper bound given by one of these q inequalities. Remember that minus x greater than or equal to something is the same as saying x is upper bounded by the negative of this right hand side over here. Alright, so we want every upper bound to be at least every lower bound. And so, combining these p and q inequalities, what we get is p times q new inequalities without x. And of course, we have to copy this over. If we solve the system of inequalities over here without x, then we can extend that solution by finding a suitable value for x that will satisfy the original system. And conversely, anything that satisfies the original system, if we throw away the x value, will satisfy this new system of inequalities that is without x. And that's the key to the Fourier-Motzkin elimination method. So in summary, what you do is, if you want to eliminate a variable, first, rewrite the inequalities so that that variable you are interested in is on the left-hand side, everything else is on the right-hand side. All the coefficients of that variable are either 1, minus 1, or 0. And for each inequality in which the variable appears positively, you pair it up with an inequality in which the variable appears negatively. So if you have p inequalities of the former and q of the latter, then you'll get p times q linear inequalities. If the new system cannot be solved by inspection, you can apply this method again. Pick another variable and apply the method. And you can actually do this until you get down to one variable, in which case it's very easy to see if there is a solution. We can now use this to prove a fundamental fact in linear programming. In linear programming, there is a theorem that says, if you have a linear programming problem, if it is not infeasible, that means there is a solution that satisfies all the constraints, and if it is not unbounded, that means if you have a minimization problem, the objective function value cannot be arbitrarily negative, then you must be able to find optimal solution. And the way we prove this is as follows. So first of all, we can assume without loss of generality that we are looking at a minimization problem that looks like this. Well, the reason is, if you have a constraint that looks like this, A transpose X equal to B, well, you can rewrite this as a pair of inequalities, satisfying this equation is the same as satisfying these two inequalities at the same time. Now, if you have a less than or equal to inequality, well, you can turn it into a greater than inequality by multiplying both sides by minus 1. So that means we can assume that all our linear constraints are greater than or equal to. And we don't have to worry about maximization problem because maximizing is equal to minimizing the negative of the function. Let's say we are given this problem. Now, we have seen an example in which we can convert this problem into something that has only one variable in the objective function. Effectively, minimizing z subject to z greater than or equal to c transpose x ax greater than or equal to b is equivalent to our original problem. If this new problem has an optimal solution, then that solution will give us an optimal solution for the original problem. And if this is infeasible, then the original problem is infeasible. And if this new problem is unbounded, then the original problem is unbounded, and so on. So basically, these two problems are equivalent. Now, what I'm going to show is that if we look at this new problem, only one of three things can happen. There's no solution, the problem is unbounded, or that it has an optimal solution. So let me call this problem P prime. Solving P prime amounts to finding among all solutions to this system one that has the minimum z value if it exists. So that's our goal, right? Solving this minimization problem is basically looking at all the solutions to this system, find one that has the minimum possible value for z. Because this is just a system of greater than or equal to inequalities, we can apply a Fourier-Motzkin elimination method to eliminate all the variables except z. And what do we know about that final system? Well, it has no other variable other than z. And every solution for the original system here, the z value must satisfy that final system. And if we have a z value that satisfies the final system, we can extend that to a solution to the original system. If we use Fourier-Motzkin elimination method to eliminate all the variables except z, that final system will tell us one of three things. It has no solution, in which case P prime is infeasible. There's no inequality of the form A z greater than or equal to gamma. Well, that means z can be as negative as we want. In that case, that means the original problem is unbounded. Or there are inequalities of this form, z greater than or equal to gamma. Now, there might not be one, just one of them, but there might be a bunch. So if there are a bunch of them, well, there are only finitely many of them because Fourier-Motzkin elimination method cannot introduce an infinite number of new inequalities. So at the end, if we do have something that says z greater than or equal to gamma, well, we might have a bunch of these. So we might end up with a number of these. All right, maybe k of these. And all we have to do is we pick z to be the largest among all these gammas. Okay? Then, well, the largest gamma will give us a lower bound that z has to satisfy. And we cannot pick anything smaller because what it has to satisfy, z has to be at least that value, right? So if the problem is not invisible and is not unbounded, then you will see a bunch of these inequalities. And the maximum value on the right-hand side of these inequalities will be the optimal value for P prime.